How I became a scholar is a very interesting question, actually. I never started my life or career with this intention to become a scholar. Scholarship happened, actually. As I was studying, I was learning things. I found that I should go much deeper into certain aspects of life. Life was something very, very fascinating for me. In my childhood, I saw certain deaths, and I found and I understood that life will come to an end, or life will cease to exist as far as an individual is concerned. Then I also learned that whatever is born is bound to die. So these things actually put certain amount of curiosity in me, and I wanted to know what is behind everything. So this took me to this aspect of curiosity, took me to the idea of knowing things more and more. I started reading. Initially my reading was very, very, very shallow, very, very two-dimensional. I read whatever came to my hands. I went on reading, and finally I came to know that certain things have to be given more focus than the other things. It's a sort of discrimination or discernment, you could say. You make your own choice. You make your own choice in terms of the books that you read, the people that you mix with, the food that you eat, the dress that you wear. So the choice became very clear for me, and I went on reading in that line. Then I started looking at a lot of works of art, paintings and sculptures. That fascinated me. I started looking at the history of these paintings and sculptures. And anything, visual art, as far as I am concerned, I don't discriminate between films or short films or photographs from painting and sculpture, the conventional mediums. But the basis is painting or a traditionally made work of art. That could be sculpture also. So my scholarship went into that level. I started learning more about art history, art criticism, etc. But at the same time, I had a strong grounding in literature. So I thought that I could create a link between literature and art. In due course of time, I also understood that while the critical tools and the historical tools are the same for both art and literature, the application of it could be entirely different when you approach literature and when you approach a work of art, a visual work of art. And if you ask me that whether I am a scholar, I don't know. That has to be judged by the people who read me, the people who try to understand me through my works, my writing mainly, and my other social engagements. But at this stage, I am thinking of something about scholarship in an entirely different way. I feel that the basic idea of becoming a scholar is very materialistic. What one needs to become is to get into that wisdom, to become a wise man. That is important. Scholarship is perhaps a gathering of information, knowledge, and the critical analysis of it, and the ability to use that that particular knowledge in certain situations. That is well and good. But there is a tremendous amount of unlearning process. You need to unlearn. The more you learn, the more you unlearn. That is where I am standing now. I want to unlearn the things that I know, and I want to understand or become aware of the things that lie beyond what is apparent. So for me, scholarship is something like learning and unlearning process, and it never ends. It goes on, and there will be a certain stage, there will be a stage where you don't need to learn at all. Everything will be known to you. So my basic striving or my basic desire is for that.
If you ask me what inspired me to become an art historian or cultural critic or art critic, I would say that my village Vakkom, that is the only inspiration I had. Or today, when I sit here, I believe that my only motivation, my only inspiration is this village, this nature, and the various aspects of this village. Of course, I have studied in cities, and I had gone to several foreign countries. I even studied in London. But the basic inspiration, the basic motivation comes from this village. Maybe at this age I recognize that. So many people have come to my life, so many people have inspired me in many different ways, so many books have inspired me, films, artists, artworks, incidents, events, so many things have inspired me. But when you look at all those things, you find that there is a filter, there is a container, or there is a cauldron in which all these things come and fall, and there is a constant churning process there. And that cauldron, that receptacle, that container is my basic place, or my basis, my foundation, which is this village called Vakkom. I was very lucky to have born here, and my neighboring village Kaikira, that you can see the other side of this island, there Kumarnashan was born. In my childhood, I used to go to this great poet's memorial hall, where I used to see two great paintings, two interesting paintings, I would say. I kept on looking at those paintings, and I found that there is something in it. More than words, those paintings were conveying me things. So I got interested. And besides, like some of my relatives were also artists. So they also sort of, guided me into this trip. But anybody, you ask anybody in this world, they perhaps give you the same answer, that their land, their own village has motivated them, inspired them. But Vakkom is something very special. Vakkom is very rich with water bodies, backwaters, and we are a seashore village, we could say. And a lot of coconut grows, lot of trees, lot of flora and fauna. And the other thing is that we are a religiously tolerant village. There are a lot of Muslims here, a lot of Hindus here, and many variants of Hindus and Muslims, different people from different economic strata. So this place is a mixture of everything. And the wonderful thing is that this whole village has got so many temples and so many mosques. So the moment you get up in the morning, you are actually received by so many devotional songs of different religions. So you are very peaceful. And there are so many libraries in this village. At least three of them I can count. There are schools in this village. And even if the things have changed by now, a lot of modernity, post-modernity, technology, everything has come to this place. And the complexion of life also has changed in this village. But what I see is the basic structure, the basic purity of this village, which actually drags me back to it. That doesn't mean that like I am going to set up my ashram or set up my place here and remain the rest of the time here, remain and live here forever. No, I'm not going to do that. But at the same time, I won't be like a stringless kite. The string is always here. There is a string, and that string is here. There is some kind of a spiritual pull to this place. So I feel I am anchored in this village. And I am very sad to listen that for the last 2 years, like any other part of Kerala or any other part of India perhaps, our village is also facing some water crisis. I feel very sad about it. And I hope the people will become more and more aware of this particular crisis, and they will do everything to save water and preserve water and conserve all the water bodies that we have in this village. So put everything into a nutshell, I would say my inspiration comes from this nature, this very earth, this land, this village called Vakkom, which is surrounded by the spirits of so many great people, so many wonderful people, so many people who are still living and the people who have dead and gone. I remember my father and so many other people who were the contemporaries of my father, and all of them are now dead and gone. But I think like their memories inspire this village to move on, to go further towards progress, spiritual progress and materialistic progress. And I'm very happy to be a part of that. When I look at my discipline, that is art history or art criticism, or I can say art in general, I always look at art within its context. I don't stand for a sort of international art. I stand for the arts of the earth, art which is rooted, art which is here and now, or art which, the kind of art that has been produced by the artists who belong to this land. I'm not talking about my village, but the artists of India. India is absolutely different. India is a great country. I'm not just claiming its greatness just because that it's very big and it has a cultural history. It has a large tradition, a great tradition. And this country was the repository of great knowledge, etc., etc. I'm not just attributing the greatness only because of those factors. The greatness comes from its people and their creative abilities, their talents. Indian people are extremely talented. Indian people are, at the same time, because of the physical and materialistic conditions, they are very adjustable to the situations. They survive. They survive in any given condition. But within that survival, they improvise a lot. And they create a lot of things. And that is why our country is great and beautiful. That's why I claim that our country is great and beautiful. But there are certain forces in our country that are trying to finish this creative talents of our own country. Our Prime Minister talks about New India. New India doesn't mean that getting all what is alien to us here or what is happening in terms of development or what is happening in terms of progress into this country from elsewhere. The New India is not that. What our Prime Minister talks about is the New India, which is created by the talents of our own country. At the same time, I want to interpret it as a New India, which is not xenophobic either. We are not afraid of East or West. We are but confident about, we have full confidence on our own abilities. We have creative talents. Let me talk about art, because that is my core area. So when I talk about art, our talents are not used. Our talents are not given enough platform to flourish. Our talents are not tapped enough. What is happening today is, when our country is developing materialistic as well as spiritual platforms for flourishing, for facilitating these talents to flourish, these geniuses to flourish, there are certain retrogressive elements in our country. They are becoming the agents of alien ideas, foreign ideas into this country, so that our abilities could be killed for a larger market. You look at certain activities that is happening in the art scene in India. There are so many, at least a few, I shouldn't say so many, there are few activities, large scale activities, which is ironically even funded by the governments, the state governments, in order to promote art and tourism. They create something which actually pushes our own abilities down. They want to create a kind of art which is so-called international, so that the international people could understand what we are doing. So that an international homogenized market is created where our artists and art could be fit into. But that is a wrong thing. If we are actually ironing out our abilities, our talents, if we are not really helping our talents to flourish, develop in a different way, the way these talents deserve, what will happen eventually? The foreign art and artists, the cultural producers, they with their own facilities, increased facilities, more sophisticated facilities, would create some kind of art and culture, and they would export it, and we would import it here, making our artists to think that they are doing something lesser. So where is this New India? Where this idea of New India would go, if that is the case? So we need to come back. We need to think about our own talents. We need to really, really look at the individual talents and the collective talent of this country. And we should help it to come up. And that should define our international. The people who come from America or Europe and see our art and say that this is native art or regional art or Indian art. But when we see their art, we say that is international art. This dichotomy, this disparity in approach should be done away with. We should see our art as well as international art. Because if you look at this country with so many varieties of people, so many varieties of cultures, so many different attitudes towards life, this country is capable enough to produce an extremely different kind of art, an extremely positive art. We are capable enough to create a new world. New India is the new world, nothing else. New India is a new philosophical world. New India is not just a new market. New India doesn't mean that we are becoming new consumers. New India doesn't mean that we are going to succumb to the new desires. No, we are going to tap our potentials. We are going to go in depth. We are going to go into our spiritual core. And we are going to find what is latent there, the energies, the capacities, the abilities, the talents to create a new world. We are going to tap it. We are going to explore it. I will never use the word exploit. Exploitation is the means and the ends of these people who create spectacular art in our country and force our artists to think that they are doing inferior art. That should not happen. The government should rethink about their strategies in funding this kind of activities. Instead of that, they should create platforms. They should create avenues. Even if they don't create platforms and avenues, they should create a conducive atmosphere, an environment for our own artists to flourish. When I talk about artists, I'm not just talking about painters, sculptors, and graphic artists or photographers and so on. I talk about those people who do any kind of creative act. Everything is science, medicine, engineering, everything is a creative thing. I'm talking about dancers, singers, circus people, circus artists, gymnasts, sports people, games people. I'm talking, these are all creative mediums we should create. And that shouldn't be, all these things should not be treated as a fruit salad. They should not be mixed up. While we appreciate there is interdisciplinary aspects in creating a culture, or in culture in itself has interdisciplinary dimensions, we should not actually bring all these things to one container and shake it up to create something. No. While accepting the interdisciplinarity, we should accept their mutual exclusivity also. So let painting flourish. Let graphic art flourish. Let photography flourish. Let music and dance flourish in their own platforms, in their own avenues, in their own environments. And at the same time, let us have a deeper and larger understanding about various kinds of art expressions, including literature. Let us create bridges. Let us create a human bonding. Let us create a human ideations, so that all the arts will flourish in a fruitful way. What is happening today is actually a lopsided thing. What is happening today is a sort of undemocratic art promotion. That shouldn't happen. When we talk about New India, we should talk about a New India created by Indians who are not xenophobic, who don't hate the foreign things. But while accepting the foreign things, they uphold the values that is created in this country, in this place, in this earth.
Many people ask me, what am I going to do in future? Many people ask me whether I am going to stay in Delhi forever. Many people ask me when am I going to have my own space. Many people also ask me, am I going to relocate to some better countries? These questions actually make me think about my future. I consider myself as a person who is an avadhut, who doesn't stay
in a place more than 2 months. That's a mental situation. It is not a physical situation exactly. Mentally, I'm an avadhut. I don't stick to things. I don't keep things so close to me. I always have created a buffer zone, a gap, a detachment with people, with the things, with emotions. That happened in me over a period of time, because I understood that closeness actually creates a lot of delusions and illusions. You get attached to things and you create a lot of confusions for yourself. That doesn't mean that I'm a person who doesn't have any emotions, any feelings. That doesn't also mean that I am unconcerned about things. I'm really concerned about so many things. But at the same time, I know that my concern doesn't make much of a difference. What makes difference in this world is my action. My actions would make the difference. If you ask another fundamental question, is the world waiting for my actions so that it could change? No. The world doesn't want my actions. The universe is complete in itself. So I am very insignificant in the whole scheme. But I understand one thing, that I am part of this whole, and my whole effort is to become a part of this whole, or to become one with the whole. But I have this materialistic body, this physical body, which I have to preserve till it is there. So long as I have a body, so long as I understand or I look at the world, experience the world through my 5 indriyas, 5 indriyas is panchendriya, I have to deal with this world, what I see as this world, because that is the perceptive reality. And when that kind of a reality is there and I am a part of it, I need to do certain things. That is the karma margam. You have to do, but you have to be slightly removed from the results of it, results of whatever you do. In that case, if I talk futuristically, I want to come back to this village. I want to set up a reference library, a research center, so that people from any part of the world could come and research on certain topics. That those certain topics are this: art, literature, philosophy, and spiritualism. If people, and I would add history also, history. If people are interested in these 5 things, if they pursue these 5 things, art, literature, philosophy, history, and spiritualism, I'm sure this world will never have any problem. Especially when you have this beautiful place around you. You have this beautiful earth to cradle you, to soothe you, to comfort you. And you have these personal interests in these 5 topics. You will turn into a beautiful human being. You don't feel like fighting for any kind of ideology, for any kind of politics, or even for economics. And as an individual, I may not be able to gather that much of an economic support from my own efforts. And I expect a few like-minded people to come together and set up an establishment where we could actually involve these 5 aspects of research, so that that becomes a hub for people to come, not just for Vakkom tourism. Vakkom tourism would happen, I can see, because the place is so beautiful. So I am not pitching my idea on tourism. I'm pitching my idea on awareness. To create better human beings, to create beautiful human beings, which is not based on deception and illusion. I want to turn this village into a knowledge hub, which would be, I'm sure, which would be a hub of wisdom rather than basic knowledge and information. If at all I have an intention to do something, to be in a place that is here, and if at all I want to do something, that is to set up this particular knowledge hub, awareness hub, a wisdom center. Like honey attracts bees, like flowers attract bees, I want wisdom to attract people. They should come and become wise people who won't actually disturb the environment, who won't misuse water, who won't fight for religion or politics, who won't live for themselves but for the universe. This nature, this world, this universe is so beautiful. It is perfect in itself. If at all I want to convey this knowledge to people, I want to create that particular thing in this village. Years back, I had written about starting an art ashram. Today, I feel that I should remove that word art from it, and there should be an ashram where these five elements could come together, stay together, and flourish. And that would be a beautiful ashram, and I'm sure that my village Vakkom is capable enough to have such an ashram.